Hello and welcome to the channel. Currently we're looking at my 87 CBR 1000. This is a project I'm kind of getting by with a kind of a stripper restoration on it. We're doing a lot of plastic, a lot of body work, as well as a couple of mechanical nags. One of which happens to be a leaking hydraulic clutch. That's not to say the clutch itself needs replacing. The clutch plates seem to be fine. But it's actually the hydraulic system itself has sprung a leak and obviously become pretty well contaminated. So we're going to be draining and dismantling the reservoir. We're going to be replacing the steel line with the braided steel line. And we actually have to service the hydraulic clutch assembly itself down at the down on the bottom end of the bike there. So let's get started. Our first step, as you might expect, is to remove the lid, the cover from our clutch reservoir. We'll go on and take a look at what horrors await us. I don't think it'll be good. Nope, that's pretty ugly. So you see it's got a nice red tinge to it. Can't tell if there's water in there, but there's definitely a lot of wax and residue that's dropped out of the solution there. So we're dealing with a very contaminated system. So we're going to have to drain this. This whole thing's coming off the bike because we're going to actually wind up servicing the internal piston here, replacing the seals, and ultimately we're going to wind up painting this so it looks nice like the brakes on the other side. As you might have guessed if you watched the Goldwing brake bleed video, we're going to be using a vacuum pump to drain the master cylinder. Next, we'll locate the bleeder screw on the slave cylinder and bleed some more of this nasty looking fluid out of the system. Remove the lower banjo bolt, noting that a crush washer is positioned on each side of the hydraulic fitting. These will need to be replaced. They're commonly available at any auto parts store. Probably a good idea to keep some rags and a catch pan nearby, because there's some fluid that's going to burp out at us here. Okay, we'll remove the upper banjo bolt. Just going to kind of work over a rag to make sure I don't wreck the pristine paint here. Now before removing the master cylinder from the bike, we'll need to disconnect the electrical connectors for the clutch lever sensing switch. Once that's done, we can loosen the two 8mm bolts holding the master cylinder onto the handlebars and remove the assembly from the bike. Then we'll take it to the bench to be cleaned and rebuilt, but before we do, I'll install the new braided stainless line. This way the routing's still fresh in our minds and we can make sure that the part is correct. I'm using a nice Spiegler kit that I've bought same time that I've done the front brakes. I went with the gold tips over black coated lines, probably a little on the boring side, but you know, my 20s are behind me and I wanted to look like upgraded stock, not some kid's flashy race bike. But if that's your thing, they got colors, all kinds of color combos to suit your style. That's not to say that I'm all that happy with my purchase. When I'd ordered this this kit from my local bike shop, it took almost 3 months to arrive up here in the waste. At which point we're in the midst of a move with a pregnant wife, whole deal. Hence why I'm only getting around to this bike now, sometime later, despite it being a good bike deserving better. Plus I definitely overpaid for what I got. Next time I'll just get a cheaper kit online from folks that can actually ship an item, not by literal ship. Lesson learned, but I digress. Next, we'll remove the slave cylinder. There's three 8mm bolts. The bottom right is long, the other two are short.
There we go. Okay. So what we're looking at here, basically, fluid comes in this passage, obviously, and then pushes this piston. And that piston pushes this pin, which actually actuates the clutch. Kind of neat. But anyway, we'll be getting a closer look at this. We're going to move it to the bench, and we're going to clean and service these components, as well as replace these rubber pieces in here, as well as we got a gasket here, unless I'm mistaken. Pretty sure I ordered one. So we've got a roasting pan full of parts, and we'll start with the master cylinder. We can detrim the parts, starting with the lever, noting that inside the lever is a little bushing, and that connects to an actuator pin that that pushes in on the master cylinder. Next, we can remove the clutch lever sensing switch and set it somewhere where it won't get lost or damaged. And then we can remove the inner workings of the master cylinder, starting with the dust boot. This has been torn. It normally attaches right onto the actuator pin, but we just use a pick and get in there and pop this thing right out. We're not worried about saving any of these parts because we do have replacements. And underneath the boot is a circlip, or a snap ring if you prefer. These are always much wow to remove. Get your snap ring pliers and get to it.
Round one, fight! Hadouken! Panic boom! But like the bird that... You lose! Round two, fight! Oh, you can! Panic boom! Panic boom! Panic boom! But like the burger! You lose, China!
Underneath the circlip is a washer. Then the piston and spring will come out. These are generally stuck together, at least in my experience. And once the piston and spring are out, the master cylinder has been dismantled, so we can thoroughly clean all the parts with brake cleaner.
So once the parts are cleaned, we're going to be painting these parts. So we're going to go over it with some Scotch-Brite. And you want to get a good scuffed surface on all this. You can't have any shiny paint, obviously. This is a pretty good rule for painting most parts. Scotch-Brite's great for these little parts. It's not going to be a base coat, clear coat system. This is going to be basically a rattle can. It's specialized for brake calipers. And you actually can bake this stuff, which helps it to harden up and to provide some chemical resistance, which is going to be perfect for this kind of application. This part, I guess I should say, this part is painted, was originally painted. I don't like it painted. Everything else in the area is aluminum colored. And it's going to be mostly covered by bodywork anyway. So I'm going to actually remove this paint. I'm just going to probably use paint stripper and a nylon brush and just kind of clean that up. But we'll do that once we've serviced the interior here. This is also a good time, before you get too far into it, to make sure that you've got your parts ready and that your parts include all these little rubber pieces that you may have destroyed servicing this component. So this boot, for example, there's no way to get that out without destroying it. And they include a new one in the kit anyway. It also has a piston, spring, washer, circlip, and then this little cap thing, which I believe, yeah, corresponds, sits right on top of that spring there. These three pieces are ready for the boot. I'm gonna do those off camera. Now the stuff we're gonna be using, it's actually this VHT. This is an old can. I got a nicer can in the booth there. But again, as I mentioned, this is designed for brake calipers. I've had good luck with it in the past. Used it on both the front brake calipers as well as the front brake reservoir. So, meet you back here in a couple hours.
Intermission.
So with the master cylinder taken care of, we can begin work on the slave cylinder. First step, we're going to use compressed air to pop this piston out. We're going to try to do so carefully. And yeah, we'll just have to see what comes out of it. I'm guessing it's going to be a bit of a mess on the inside. Just that easy. So yeah, there we go. So she has a bit of a mess. It's actually not that bad. I should be able to clean that up pretty quickly. Here's the piston itself, along with the spring, and looks like at least one little rubber gasket we'll be replacing, and one other on the inside. Yeah, there it is. So we'll be replacing this one, as well as looks like a sealing gasket on the outside somewhere. Maybe that one. Ah, here. This thing here. So. Now we're just going to use some paint stripper on this part here. Now this paint's so chemically damaged, I don't think it's going to put up too much of a fight anyway. Now we just set this stuff on there. Leave it for about 10 minutes and should come off very easily. It's working. Now while that thing's chugging away, we're going to service the piston itself here. So I imagine this just pries right off. Okay, so there's the piston seal. There's the spring, and the central oil seal here. Yeah, I don't see a lot of way of getting that out without destroying it. Okay, so finally got the oil seal out. It's actually got this little ring on the inside of it, which is a little confusing to me. I just popped it out using one of these picks here. With the slave cylinder cover all cleaned up, may as well. I don't think this is really going to be anywhere near service limit, but we may as well take a mic to it and just make sure. And yeah, as expected, measures about 1.404, and service limit is 1.403, so we're in good shape. Now you also want to make a visual inspection. Just make a point of kind of looking over the edges here, make sure there's no scoring or deep grooves or even chips. Now for the slave itself, if you like, you can do a you can put a bore gauge in it. I'm going to skip that. So reassembly is essentially the reverse of disassembly. What we are going to need is we need some brake fluid. At least this particular system takes .4. Or you can use brake lubricant such as this. And essentially we start with our rebuild kit here. I'm going to put the oil seal on. The flare goes out towards the bottom of the piston. So you want to make sure that that seal seats in there properly around the whole circumference of the piston. Then this oil seal goes in the middle. Just kind of pops in there. Again, just make sure it's well seated. Now the spring attaches onto the bottom of the piston like that. Now I'm going to use the fancy stuff here. Though there is nothing wrong with using brake fluid. And I'm just going to apply a little bit of lubrication to the outside of this seal here.
Doesn't need to be anything too crazy. Then we can essentially drop it in here. And there. Next, we could reattach the bleeder screw. So I just cleaned this up with a wire wheel. It actually wasn't in too bad a shape. Again, these things don't take very much torque. And we'll attach the new cap here. There. So with that on, the slave cylinder has been serviced here. We can reassemble this, reinstall this back on the bike. Now, before we can reinstall the slave cylinder, we'll need to remove the old gasket and clean up the mating surface. And I use razor blades for this, just more out of habit than anything. They tend to be very finely machined, or ground at least. Better than gasket scrapers, any of those cheap dollar tools. If you are going this route, just be careful not to dig into the aluminum. Now while I was at it, I went and removed the old overspray from the chain housing. Now if you're watching this video and you're new to motorcycle paint and body, let me just take a sec to shoot some old wisdom rays in your direction. When you're painting parts, whether it's a fairing, exhaust, or anything else that's bolted onto the bike, just honestly do yourself a favor and remove it from the bike first. Remove it from the bike, and it will be so much easier. You'll be able to clean the part better, you'll be able to prep it better, you won't be on your knees trying to paint an awkward angle. You'll get a better result with literally less effort. And you won't get paint all over these non-painted parts and risk the ire of whoever owns the bike after you. You can half-ass so many things in life, but half-assing a paint job is just throwing all those expensive materials and all that time and effort right down the drain. Do it decently or just don't bother. Now, the kit I bought didn't include a gasket for this. I could have gone and ordered one. I think they're about $5, but I was feeling lazy. So I just cut one out of gasket paper. It's not a fluid seal anyway, which we can tell from this notch at the bottom of the housing.
And we'll just kind of make sure the pin lines up to the piston on the inside.
Next, we'll install the banjo bolt with a fresh crush washer on each side of the hydraulic fitting. We're just going to go finger tight for now until we get the entire system assembled. This will allow us the freedom to dismantle it if we have to.
I actually carved this out of a hockey puck, going all full Canadian on you guys here. I just used an Ulfa knife and then drilled out the center and then sliced this out. And this allows me to get it around the line here to fit it into this retainer there. And this will hold the line in place much better than just having this flop around. And that's going to come in handy when we try to set our tension up on the handlebars there to make sure that we get a full range of steering motion without tying up the cable or anything like that. So we'll just kind of slide that in and then meet this to kind of fit right in there like that. And there. So until we torque this lower fitting down, this part of the job is complete. So we're going to head back to the bench, we're going to rebuild the master cylinder at this point. So, in order to reassemble the master cylinder, we just need our parts here, and I've checked to make sure that these are the same as the ones we pulled out of there. So we'll start with the spring and secondary cup, and the secondary cup actually needs a little bit of brake fluid on it, just to lubricate it. Let's use clean brake fluid, obviously. I'm just going to use one of these little parts trays, just so I don't make a big mess all over everything else here.
Now the cup seats on top of the spring, and the wide part of the spring goes in first. It's not super clear from the way I filmed this here.
Next, I will put the piston in. Again, it just takes a little bit of brake fluid on the seal here. Next, you install the washer, as well as the circlip.
Now for the boot. I'll have to issue a correction. Where you see me here installing the boot without the actuator pin, in hindsight, this is going to make it really difficult to assemble later. It's a much better idea to install the boot and pin as a set, that is to install the boot onto the pin, then to slide that in, and then seat the boot into the master cylinder. Honestly, it's just going to make your life miserable to do it any other way. Now, for some of these moving parts, it's a good idea to use some assembly grease. This will help keep the parts moving nicely and will help suppress any corrosion. Now, I went out and bought a new lever and bushing since the old ones are pretty rashed up, and OEM are commonly and cheaply available. We drop the bushing into the lever, then mate with the actuator pin before bolting in place at the pivot point. I'll skip ahead so you don't have to watch me struggle to install the dust boot and the actuator pin. Finally, we install the clutch lever sensing switch and mount the unit on the handlebars.
So there is markings on this that indicate what direction is up. Not sure if it makes a huge difference. And there's a little punch mark right on the top of the handlebar itself, which lines up right with the seam. That way you know you've got it aligned properly. Sure, if your ergonomics demanded it, you could move this thing around. Good and tight.
It's a good idea to put the reservoir lid on to keep dirt and water out of the system. And make sure to connect the switch wires. I don't think the bike will start without them.
Now we'll need to put a crush washer on the inside and on the outside of the banjo fitting. And we'll want to make sure that it can move freely throughout steering radius, which looks good. Then we'll need to torque down. This particular fastener takes 22 pound-feet of torque. There we go. And I put this masking tape on just to try to preserve the finish of this bolt. A lot of these banjo bolts are kind of an anodized aluminum finish. And so it's really easy to scratch and ding those up. And you wind up wondering why you bothered to replace the part at all.
Now we bleed the system. Make sure that the reservoir doesn't dry out. Again, this is a pretty standard rule with bleeding. If you let the reservoir dry out, it's just going to suck air into the system and you wind up having to essentially start the job over again. Also, since it's a completely empty system, it's going to take a little longer than usual. I've sped this up. As before, once we get a solid liquid column with a stream of tiny bubbles, we're done. If you'd like more detail on bleeding operations, please feel free to check out my other my brake bleed video.
Finally, you can reassemble the
master cylinder. Now you want to check for firm lever here, and actually that fits pretty good. So the final step, we'll get our can of brake clean out, and we'll spray down some of these fittings. Just make sure that nothing's leaking out. We'll do the same down on the slave cylinder. So once again, bomb the area with some brake cleaner, let that flash off. Or if you're in a rush, you can just kind of dab it up like this. And then depress the lever. And just check to make sure that you don't have any little seeps coming through here. Looks good. This one's a victory. Thanks for watching.